In order to understand modern philosophy, we have first to realize that it has different inclinations, so to speak. Beginning with Descartes, Spinoza, Leibniz, Kant, Hegel, and all the great thinkers of the ancient times, great philosophers, were in a general characterization called rationalists, including Plato, Aristotle, St. Augustine, and Thomas Aquinas. However, when we talk about Thomas Aquinas, we have to be very careful. Thomas Aquinas cannot be easily fit into the, so to speak, airtight division, rationalism, and the other group is so-called empiricistic in nature. And here we have such names like John Locke, John Stuart Mill, and Thomas Aquinas, is here not absolutely out of place. About Thomas Aquinas, we shall talk a lot more in subsequent lectures. But it is essential to distinguish between the so-called rationalistic bent of mind in some thinkers and the empiricistic. The empiricists, beginning, as I already mentioned, with John Locke, through David Hume, John Stuart Mill, until to Bertrand Russell. It is fundamental to understand what really is here at stake. What is this ground of this big divide, so to speak? It is a matter of knowledge about the nature and the reaches, so to speak, the possibilities of human knowing. It is presupposed, of course, both by rationalists and empiricists, that man are capable of knowing, that there is such a thing that we call knowledge. The distinction comes in, and the big divide comes in, when we ask how much, how deep, what are the limits and the possibilities of the abilities of the human mind? We said already that philosophy essentially is concerned with the so-called ultimate questions. It always was, beginning with the ancients until modern times also. Those questions are, for example, is there any durable, deeper meaning for human existence? Is life meaningful in some durable, permanent, perhaps eternal sense? Next, Does God exist? Or is religion and belief in God a sort of a wishful thinking, a kind of nice illusion for some people only? Because, of course, we do have atheists, individuals who do not believe in God. Third, does causality, for example, exist? So, rationalism asserts that the human mind is capable of solving the possibilities, the power, so to speak, of the human mind is sufficient to give a definite, certain, absolute answer to such fundamental questions which we just mentioned, which I just pointed out. Rationalists, therefore, will be clearly distinguishing between real philosophy and a sort of shallow philosophizing only. The philosophy, for example, of Descartes, Leibniz, before that, Plato, and especially Aristotle, is a excursion into the eternal, not only the temporal, not only the whatever is given here and now through sense experience, but the mind, beginning with sense data, has the power to arrive at absolute final cause, some being which transcends anything within this world of sense experience, time and space. Empiricists, however, insist that this is actually an illusion. The empiricist insists that we can really have only valuable and valid knowledge of what we can somehow measure, experience through my mind, through our senses, through our perceptions. Sense data, therefore, for empiricism are the final criterion of true knowledge. Many so-called scientists of our times would agree with such definition of knowledge. Knowledge, for many scientific definitions, scientifically speaking, if you like, knowledge means that ultimately experience some sort of tangible, measurable, experienceable data are the foundation and the ultimate criterion of knowing. If such data are not given, then the speculations going beyond and transcending such knowledge are futile. They necessarily lead into contradictions, paralogisms, and so forth. Many of the Empiricists are therefore, almost by definition, doubters when it comes to the fundamental philosophical issues, which I call the perennial issues of philosophy, such as those mentioned a minute ago here. Empiricists ending up in skepticism, conscience, idealists, pragmatists, positivists, dialectical materialists, and so-called existentialists, who are also against building in philosophy any systematic, unified and coherent vision of all reality. Such trends all somehow exist in our times. But by the very first principles, the existence, for example, of God, which certainly anyone will acknowledge as very deep, fundamental and perennial question, having tremendous influence on the meaning, sense, and purpose, any whatsoever value of human existence. Existence of God in such empiricistic views certainly cannot be proven, cannot be really established solidly, philosophically. Therefore, we have here those two basic camps, a sort of a great divide in philosophy. And it begins, as already mentioned, with the definition, the concept, the notion of what is to know, what is knowing, what ambience does knowing present. The rejection by empiricists of the ability of the human mind to assent to the very beginning, the very fundamental reality, such as some sort of divine reality, rejection of this already includes the human mind only within the here and the now. That means a philosopher for empiricists should not try to transcend in his researches the concrete, some sort of experiential evidence in his system. Or else he is transgressing the fundamental principles. What does it mean to know? The definition of such kind of knowledge comes from the concept of what really is the human mind. Is there such a thing like the human mind? Now, obviously, if we put the question, does a human mind exist? All thinking persons would say, of course, there is a power, something in man this knowing ability, this with which we know, perceive, think, analyze, and so on. Only the question is, how far this mind is allowed, so to speak, to go. With empiricism, of course, atheism is very closely connected. It is not necessary really to mention that empiricism in some instances, in some minds, like David Hume, for example, led to radical skepticism. And skepticism usually is described as the attitude of someone who says, we cannot know. True knowledge about those ultimate questions is impossible. I know that I don't know. David Hume, one of the renowned British philosophers, came to the conclusion that really what we have is only, nothing else, mathematical statements, which he accepted as valid. 2 and 2 is 4, for example. And sense perceptions. Nothing else really exists. What really is there, we don't know. We have only sense data, sense impressions, and we must stay within the limits of what senses deliver us. In the Humean attitude, man is defined simply as a bundle of perceptions. Hume also denied the existence of causality. As a matter of fact, we hardly know that there is a universe in such a context, because we are closed in within sense data only. In one of his writings, Hume says that no matter how long he tried to discover his ego, his self, his thinking self, he never could do that. He only got sense impressions. Naturally, if one accepts such an attitude, then we have a complete enclosure within the borderlines of whatever is given to me here and now in sense experience. Skepticism of this kind perhaps is not so widespread. But, as I mentioned, Hume did have a following, was known and renowned as a philosopher, and in many minds of modern men, there is this quiet, skeptical attitude. And it creates the atmosphere of our modern times. Our modern times are, as mentioned already in a previous lecture, defined as very chaotic. Man seemed to, very many people seemed to be deprived of any really deep faith, deep convictions, deep systems of understanding themselves, the world, and possibility of some sort of God, human destiny, and so on. With this, of course, the values, the everyday values and judgments made on the basis of those values will naturally be commensurate of such doubtful, shallow way of thinking. No matter what we say and pretend, it will remain always true that what we really deeply think and believe, this is the way we shall live. Skepticism leads to complete and radical negation of any solid basis of conviction, of direction in life. What remains is only what is convenient, what is liked at the time, what seems to be giving and filling up the emptiness of the human spirit, all the transitory, short, momentary experiences in this short life. Coming back to our problem between empiricism and rationalism, the empiricist insists, as we said, that our mind is passive. In other words, contrary to Plato, some other thinkers too, we do not bring into this world innate ideas. We are tabula rasa, in other words, completely empty slates are our minds at birth. This is the attitude of empiricists. On the other hand, the rationalists believe that the human mind is by no means only passive. The human mind is an active, analyzing actively, entering into the very nature and constitution and metaphysical structure of anything that exists. Whatever exists is being. It somehow has the act of existence. It is being. And there are all kinds of beings making up of what we would say today, the so-called cosmos or the universe. The analysis, however, of beings leads the mind to discover the existence of what a thing is and that a thing is. The fact that something exists as being means it has an act of existence. It simply is not nothingness. It has some beingness reality. Existing, it exists, it is an existent. But each existence also has some metaphysical essence, some inner constitution, some inner structure. And this we shall call the essence of a thing. The essence is this, which answers to the question, what is it? What is it? A piece of rock, a tree growing over there in the garden, a chicken, a dog, a human being, a table in front of me, and so on. Each of those mentioned entities are existents, but of course a piece of rock is not a living dog, and a growing tree is not cut lumber ready to be burned, cut down, because a tree is a living, developing being. And so is everything else that I call living. It has some definite functions. Growth, self-development, self-healing, transmutation of energy and matter from outside into its own constitution, capacity to replicate, all of those basic functions are part and essence of anything that we can say it is living. None of those I can really honestly say applies to a piece of rock, which I find, let's say, at the seashore. There is none of those functions present. It is essential to understand this observation is fundamental to any sound, valid philosophy, to any true vision of reality. If someone does not acknowledge those basic distinctions, naturally, of course, there is the way towards all kinds of fantasies, all kinds of pseudo-knowings, and so on. But it is obvious that if the beginning of my reflections, my thinking, is already somehow unclear and by principle false, I can never arrive really with assurance to a true vision. If the premises are false in a syllogism, I cannot really get a sound, valid conclusion. Now, as we saw, the basic distinction is the concept of what really is the mind. For those who believe in solving the ultimate problems of philosophy, which we mentioned already, the mind is active agent of analysis and penetration of whatever is given to scrutiny, analysis, consideration, definition. When I look and see the growing tree in the garden, I am not just seeing patches of color. or some separate sense impressions, I really see a tree, a definite entity with definite characteristics, which I categorize this as a, let's say, oak tree. The mind is able to penetrate into the structure and the definition of a bee, into the very essence of things. This is why the fundamental questions, our concepts, are universal. When I talk about dog, a dog, let's say, my concept of dog is clear. I have some idea, some concept, some notion of what really a dog is. It is a universal concept because it covers not a number of individuals, some individuals, it covers all dogs, not just one, two, or some, but all. When I talk about a human being, I'm talking about each human being, about all human beings, and so forth with other concepts. Our concepts are universal. This is also a fundamental beginning in sound philosophy. Things by themselves, things in themselves, are individual, are singular. A dog walking in the street is this one dog. Another one will be second one dog, and so on. But my concept, my idea of dog, what is a dog, is universal. It applies to all dogs. It is similar to a well-known from the first study of logic, the famous syllogistic statement. All men are mortal. This is the universal first premise. Socrates is a man. Conclusion follows without doubt. Socrates is mortal. If I would have no, at least one universal concept, the syllogism would lead nowhere. For example, I could say, some swans are white, some apples are red. So what? Any conclusion? None whatsoever. Because from some to some, conclusion doesn't follow. There must be at least one universal premise in any valid and sound deductive thinking example. Because it always starts with all and ends up with less. The conclusion can never assert more than is already present in the premises. This is only to illustrate by deductive thinking what is meant by universal concept. Now, if somebody is a radical empiricist, somehow skeptical. He will probably want to deny that our concepts are universally valid. He will try to narrow it down to a limited number, and so on and so on. But whenever empiricist or skeptic tries to do it, he is really going beyond the field of solid logic. Now, what is then skepticism really? Skepticism is a forceful, unjustified denial of ability to philosophize in the serious, fundamental, perennial way. It's like saying the mind cannot do it. Why? Because of the insistence from the beginning on the experimentality of anything, any statement, any belief that is based on knowledge. It is a denial, it is robbing the mind of its natural abilities, cutting its ability and limiting it to the sense data here and now. And here a word or two about science. What really is a scientist doing? Scientists, of course, have minds. Scientists develop all kinds of far-reaching theories of all kinds of hypotheses. Scientific theories are by no means restricted within the time and space limits of the here and the now. For example, the theory of the beginning of the universe, the so-called Big Bang. It is the reaching of the mind hundreds and thousands of millions, perhaps, light years into the past. Although I am doing the thinking in my room in, let's say, year 2012 BC. Nevertheless, a scientist insists that he is only within the limits of palpable experimentation, palpable sense data. An intellectualist or rational person would say, yes, you are in it. You begin with sense data by analyzing sense data. You are experimenting and then creating a hypothesis, and if hypothesis is confirmed again and again and again within the same field of study, say biology, astronomy, psychology, and so on, then we have a scientific theory. A scientist is actually universalizing the givens of experience. Therefore, it is important to understand that a scientist who would be a radical skeptic, really believe that only what I can see and touch and measure is real should not really create that far-fetched, outside of time and space, scientific theories. But his purpose as a scientist is precisely to develop such theories using the inductive method of thinking and reasoning. Because from several experiences, experimentations, he is concluding into also a universal law of nature. And the idea of law, what is the idea of law? A law means that that nature has regularity in developing different changes, different facts, different happenings. There is a regularity, orderliness in nature, which means stability in time and space. Otherwise, no scientific knowledge would be possible at all. There would be no such thing like science. We would be sentenced only to what we now and here at this time perceive sensually. Sense data, our perceptions, which rapidly follow each other. As William James used to say, the stream of consciousness. Our minds, however, go back into the past. Every astronomer will tell you today that when you look at the sky, you never know what are you really looking at. Because you are looking into the past. And the past, by definition, may not be now, may not be present. It is past. This comes from the fact that the speed of light is 300,000 kilometers per second, or 186,000 miles per second. Per second. Now, the distances between different galaxies and stars, which we see at night, on a clear night, are going into thousands and millions of light years. The light, therefore, from the original planet or star or galaxy, from its source, has to travel through this tremendous, beyond imagination, large, long space until it hits the retina of my eye. So when I look at the sky, what do I see? Is this what I call, there is a star, still a star, or do I see simply the light which was sent so many, tremendously many light years away in the past? Telescopes, microscopes, all the equipment which is available to modern scientists is a tremendous advantage because it broadens immeasurably the human horizon of thought, the horizon of the human mind. This is why very many people have this tremendous respect, sometimes exaggerated respect, for what is called science today. I said exaggerated respect. Yes, because no scientific theory, true and so on, is absolute, final, and beyond any change. Scientific theories were different in the past. Scientific theories are very much different in our times. And there is hardly any doubt that what today is considered the final, so to speak, absolutely true theory in this or that science is the final word. Why? Simply because what we know is not very much yet. And what we do not know about the universe and reality is practically still infinite. There is no sense in saying that the future generations to come will have to stay with the scientific views in all sciences of our time. Many theories, once again, which were true in the past, are discarded. And many scientific theories are sometimes subject to revision, modification, or sometimes complete change. This is essential to remember. Philosophy is looking and searching. It is analyzing and trying to reach the absolute, the final, eternal realities. The fundamental questions which I mentioned before in this lecture. This is the area of philosophical reflection. And naturally, for us humans, truth is absolutely desirable. All men want to know. Somehow we know that knowledge is good, that knowledge is something to be striving for, that knowledge is valuable, that knowledge is light and possibly, eternal life. This is also the reason why philosophy quite often is related tightly to what we call religion. And again, when we talk about religion, we must be careful, what are we talking about? Because we can go into a forest of all kinds of ideas and concepts which will lead us only confused and frustrated. We are talking sometimes about pantheism, monotheism, polytheism, atheism, and all the other isms, so to speak. Our Western concept of religion is based on the Judeo-Christian tradition, the Muslim tradition of Mahomet, primarily about those two, but also we have some similarities in the concept of religion with Hindus, for example, Buddhists, and so on. The fundamental facts of religion are the existence of an infinite, all-powerful, all-perfect cause, first cause of all reality, creator, God. Invisible, infinite, all-powerful spirit. Absolutely real. Absolutely real. All else, all the many beings are derivative from God, are created by His all-powerful let there be. The Jews and Christians have their Bible, the Genesis book. The Muslims have the Quran and so on, other religions also. And naturally, it creates also a confusion. The fact that we know that there is not absolutely one religion, but there are different religions. Some which confess, let's say, one God. This is Christianity, Judaism, Muslim religion. To an extent only, the Hindu idea of Brahma. But Hinduism, in many respects, is pantheism. So, naturally, it occurs to everyone who thinks, why is this so, that we have many religions? This is not a topic into which I want to enter in this present lecture. This is a topic which we shall discuss in a series of lectures under the title Religions of the World. But the important thing is that religion is very close always to some sort of philosophy, some philosophical vision, and they should and do go together. A true believer in our times is not only somebody who believes, let's say, in Jesus Christ, but when confronted with atheists or Muslims or some other Buddhists and so on, or perhaps materialists, evolutionists, and who knows what, who laugh at his convictions, he should be capable to prove, to show the fundamental rationality of his belief. He should be able to show that it is a rational commitment to the final ultimate reality with absolute certainty. He has to have, therefore, ability to give philosophical underpinning to his religious convictions. Of course, a Muslim, and another one, also they will claim the rationality of their beliefs. This leads finally to the mutual confrontation and hopefully ecumenical understanding. Philosophy, therefore, coming back to our main topic, philosophy in modern times, is this great reaching. Unfortunately, let's say, divided between the so-called empiricists and so-called rationalists. The word rationalists should be taken very cautiously and with qualifications. The main difference between is the attitude a philosopher takes to the ambience, power, possibility of the human mind. If he shrinks those possibilities to sense data only, if he prescribes from the very start, without solid grounds, the reason for those limitations, he is already cutting down the very branch on which he sits. And skepticism, and this is important to remember, has no real solid self-justification. Because once again, a skeptic is trying reasonably to convince another person that knowledge is impossible. But in order to this, he already presupposes that he has some knowledge, because to begin a rational discussion, he must have already some knowledge. Now, it is somewhat comic when somebody tries by reasoning nullify reasoning. Skepticism is not really valuable, neither is it possible. Now, coming back to René Descartes, who is, as I mentioned already in those lectures, René Descartes is called the father of modern philosophy. The primary concern of René Descartes was how to establish an indubitable some ground on which some fact, some reality, some function on which to build a certain system of true knowledge. The methodical doubt, therefore, was the beginning of modern thinking. René Descartes was educated by Jesuit in La Flèche, but he came to this moment in life when he says, well, how do I truly know that what I believe is really certain? Doubt crept into his mind. all his philosophy, actually, all that he can offer is this method how to find an unshakable, absolutely indubitable foundation for certain thought, for certain philosophy. We know that he came down through history with the famous saying, I think, therefore I am. After a search for a long time, he thought that the answer was precisely here. I think. There is an I, and this I is thinking, is doing the process of reasoning. I think. This is beyond any possibility of evasion. I think, he says, therefore I am. If there is I thinking, then I exist. Therefore I am. Can this be doubted? René Descartes said it cannot be doubted. Theoretically, I mean technically speaking, I can doubt. There might be doubt, but doubting is a kind of thinking. To doubt is also to think, because doubting is a category of thought. So I can never evade the fact that I think, even if I doubt. Therefore, I think, therefore I am. He also developed the theory of man. Man is a composite of mind and body. And we have the self of man divided, so to speak, into two radically different realities. The mind is not in space, not extended. It is a simple spiritual power of thought, part of the essence of the self. But the self also has a body. The muscles, the skeletal, the digestive system, the whole organism is a unified, this living human being. So obviously man has a body. Man is body, we can say. Now, body is, according to Descartes, something extended in space. Body occupies some dimensions, some little particle of space. Mind is not extended. And the question immediately appears, how is it possible that an unextended mind somehow directs an extended body? This is the question, the perennial question, which is present very much with us today, in our times and philosophy too. The relationship between body and mind. How do they influence each other? Materialists, empiricists, quite often reduce the mind to some sort of fundamentally, ultimately material processes. The mind is epiphenomenon of matter. It is like an outglow, so to speak, of the focus of matter, of material changes. If the human organism is somehow handicapped, or the brain, if there's a brain tumor or other cancer of brain or whatever, mutilation of some sort of the brain, which is the center, for materialists, the center of consciousness and thought, the person cannot think properly. The person can simply lose the ability to orient oneself in the environment, think logically, rationally, and so on. So the materialists say, oh, you see, obviously you can see that there is no such thing like an independent reality you call mind, different from material processes. If the material organism, the brain especially, doesn't function, there is no thinking, there is no logical reflection, and so on. On the other hand, those who believe that there is an essentially radically different in nature mind, spiritual reality, mind, the self, endowed with the mind, radically different from matter, are saying, but the mind directs the thoughts. The mind makes the organism operate. The man makes a decision to raise their hand, and he or she raises the hand. There is an independent content of many ideas in the mind, independent of matter. Logic is not really an epiphenomenon of matter at all. It is not the body which decides for me. I recognize some necessities. I make choices. I realize the truth of some realities, some facts. I judge. I affirm and deny, and so on. I act. I am using the material organism, the flesh, and all the systems which enter into the structure of this living organism. A medical person would develop all kinds of indications, describe the constitution of the body, the different systems which unite it into oneness, skeletal system, digestive system, circulatory system, nervous system, genitourinary system, and so on and so on. The amazing and the astounding fact about a living being is let's say, in the living organism of a man, that all those systems cooperate with each other in the development, maturation of the living human being, with all the processes which are necessary for nutrition, for self-healing, propagation, change of matter from outside into the building stuff of the organism, and so on. What's more, we know that in every cell of the human being, there is a storage of knowledge, so to speak, a sort of prescription, how to build the whole organism, the double helix. Now very much known in our times. The RNA, DNA, and all that. The whole organism is comparable to a book written minutely in a stored encapsulation in four letters only. The regularity, the amazing functioning, and the building of the whole into one living organism is a standing, surprising wonder of any serious thinker. So, to summarize briefly, modern philosophy, we see that we have this great divide, rationalism, intellectualism, let's say, and empiricism. Empiricism finally leading to skepticism in David Hume, and also Immanuel Kant, who actually denied metaphysics as a valid way of thinking. All this doubting search on one's own began with René Descartes. About René Descartes and later on,